Well, hello. Thank you all for joining this talk about vintage computing. Originally, this talk was held at the bol.com Tech Summit, and I forgot to bring the original presentation, so I completely redid the format. So we'll just have to see how things go. If you have any questions during the presentation, please feel free to ask them. I'll be more than happy to answer them. So yeah, here we go. Short introduction about myself. I've been fooling around with Unix operating systems since 1997. Started out playing with DEC Alpha systems around the time. Played a lot with Slackware and NetBSD. Tried out most of the other Unix operating systems in between. And somewhere in 2002, I actually started working as a Unix engineer and have been doing that ever since. Nowadays, it's all just Linux and not as exciting as it used to be, of course, but yeah, we can't have it all. So, first off, why the hell would you want to do vintage computing? Because, yeah, we're talking about huge-ass machines. We're talking about big power consumption. We're talking about incomprehensible systems, and why the hell would I do it? Because my phone is faster. Well, there are actually a bunch of reasons that make it really fun. You can compare the process a little bit with like restoring an old car. It's like, it's not going to be useful, but it is fun, and it has its own vintage, and it has its own style, and getting something to work can be a big achievement. It's also really nice to work with operating systems for which you cannot find the answers on Stack Overflow. In a sense, it trains your sense of troubleshooting and debugging and investigating operating systems. It forces you to, use your skills to dig deeper to get stuff to work. So it is actually, and those skills, if you bring them to modern day operating systems, they just allow you to work with them much more easily and efficiently because, yeah, basically it's all the same ever since Unix was invented, so why not? The classical approach to vintage computing is all about having your own systems. I used to be a bit, I'm still a big collector, big systems take up lots of space. The power consumption is huge. Most of these systems have electronic components that date back 20, 30, 40 years. They just all dry out, they break. Stuff breaks, you need expensive equipment, you need advanced electrical skills to work with them. They take up a huge amount of space, they take lots of power. Most of the time, it's pretty hard to get it done. The older the systems get, the more rare the actual components and spare parts become. So over time, it just becomes more harder and harder to actually own a vintage computer system. As a small example, I've got a VUX 4000 upstairs. That system has DSSI hard disks. Those disks were built in the time right before the SCSI standard was invented. DEC and IBM offered DSSI as an alternative. Well, DEC and IBM lost out to SCSI, and all of a sudden, DSSI hard disks are really rare to find, especially the DEC ones, because DEC is already long gone. There are stories known about hobbyists building their own clean rooms, disassembling their own hard drives, replacing all the rubbers and bearings, and, well, trying to get a disk back to work, because there is no other way, basically. These are a bunch of systems just to give you a feeling about which size systems we're talking about. These are fairly small systems, actually. Over on the left, on the right, we have an old NetApp storage array, which, if I'm not mistaken, came from Access4All. Could very well be. I forgot the exact origin. We have a bunch of 5U alpha servers, which are, I really love them, but yeah, they're big, bulky, and this one even, this is 1.4 gigahertz CPUs, so not really useful actually. Over on the top, this is one of my biggest systems. This is the size of a small fridge, and an IBM AS400, which is like a hybrid system in between mainframes and mini computers. And you basically interface with it through a forms language, and it has a DB2 database installed, and that's just it. It's a really funky system, and I haven't yet been able to get it to work because I don't have a token ring network. This is pretty unfeasible, and this actually caused a lot of collectors to just stop collecting because it just became unfeasible. Because of this, a bunch of old engineers started writing their own emulators to preserve the history of all the operating systems they've written, the software they've written. Nowadays, there is a huge collection, well, a big collection of emulators available, which allow you to basically emulate all the major systems from the end of the 50s up until mid-90s and everything in between. All these emulators also have networking support, modern-day Linux utilities allow you to easily configure a bridge on your system. This also allows you to build a complete networked emulated environment, which can allows you to fool around with the protocols that the internet has been based on, for instance. And of course, that's really good. Because you don't have all, don't consume all the power. It doesn't take much space. You just run it on your laptop. So this is really nice. There are a bunch of different approaches to building emulators, depending on the type of emulation, the system will be slow or fast, basically. The two biggest approaches are just-in-time translation emulated processors and fully emulated systems. Both have their advantages and drawbacks, and I will closely touch upon a bunch of them. So, for instance, with JIT compiling, what will happen is that each CPU instruction that gets executed by the emulated CPU gets translated in near real time to the underlying corresponding system call of the host CPU. Depending on the type of emulator, this allows you to reach near native speeds with an operating system that runs inside an emulator. This approach is used mostly by mission-critical systems that have been in existence since, for instance, the 50s. They still need to keep running. For instance, to run a nuclear power central or another big mission-critical system. Those systems were built with old hardware. Those things expire over time. They ran into the same issues. So in comes the JIT compiler. It basically means you can take your modern day, I don't know how many core Xeon CPU system, run a JIT emulator on there, and boom, you have the fastest PDP-11 or FOX in existence. And it will just run circles around the original hardware. That also means that as a hobbyist, getting a hold of JIT emulators is really hard because the the market for these emulators is really small, and the people that spend time on them to build them, they have a really small customer base, and they would much rather prefer people buy their emulators than people downloading them, even though it's a restricted edition, and running their favorite operating system on there. Because companies still abuse the same rules to run their own application without paying. Yeah. Another approach, and it's actually a approach that gets implemented in Twofold, is an emulated CPU. With the case of the emulated CPU, you program the characteristics of a certain CPU in software. You run that as a state machine on your local system, and the native system just sees another user process running, and inside there you have a fully emulated processor with all attached hardware running. This, of course, has disadvantages because, yeah, emulating a complete CPU is very, very slow. However, most of the systems that you will be emulating, the original hardware that it ran on was so slow anyway that you're not going to notice a difference. And personally, I've ran setups based on quad-core systems with SSD-backed storage that just run circles around the original hardware. It's crazy. However, for some people, the software-based approach is not enough. So there are also people that actually implement a CPU in hardware. Most of these projects are built around FPGA boards, and people use Verilog or VHDL to fully write their own emulator. I'm going to touch up on a bunch of them. The first one, which I find the most cool, is a guy who desperately wanted to own his own Cray-1, a supercomputer. These supercomputers were mostly built for three-letter agencies. Getting your hands on one of these as a collector is next to impossible. Getting software which runs on this is even harder. This guy, he found the original documentation for the hardware architecture. Based on that, he wrote his own VHDL setup, which is turned out to be a binary accurate, cycle accurate emulation of the original hardware that runs on the Cray 1A. The big disadvantage is because he didn't have his hands on the software, he wasn't able to try it out up to a couple of months ago when he accidentally came into contact with one of the original developers of the Cray, which handed him a bunch of disk packs, and at this moment he is busy reverse engineering the electrical interface for the disk packs so he can restore the original operating system and actually get this thing to run again, which is pretty impressive in my opinion. This system is a scale model. It's, I guess, yeah, this big, not that big, instead of the original huge-ass system. So this is a really nice approach to vintage computing, in my opinion. Another really nice box, but it's a little bit hard to see. This is also FPGA based. This is an implementation of a PDP-11. Over here in the corner, we have a really small FPGA board, which is emulating this big PDP-1170 that's standing behind it. You can just download all the VHDL files, both for this project and the previous project. Get yourself a board, and you're able to have a proper emulation of all the different PDP-11 CPUs that have ever run including most of the hardware that used to be attached to there, emulated, of course, but you can still run it. These projects are still pretty expensive for people that just want to fool around with technology. So a couple of other options which are also really nice are the so-called PyDP8 and PyDP11. This started out about 2 years ago with the PyDP8. There is this guy who, for the 50th anniversary of the PDP8, built his own 1-in-10 scale model of a PDP8 front panel. The front panel is attached to a Raspberry Pi that's connected behind it, running an emulator with a PDP8 on there. And he wrote a special driver that allows the emulated CPU to be connected to the front panel. So all the buttons, all the LEDs you see here and all the buttons that are connected there, they directly program the emulated CPU that's behind it. Because this thing was such a success, the guy also built a skill model for a PDP-11. The big difference between the two systems is that the PDP-8 is, for modern day enthusiasts, mostly interesting as a method to learn how a CPU works, because you're not able to perform all the process control functions that used to come with the original system. However, the PDP-11 allows you to run both Unix with TCP/IP stacks. It allows you to run various other operating systems with TCP/IP stacks, and it allows you a somewhat more closer experience to what you're maybe used to with your modern day operating systems. And of course, the whole front panel is functional, and it acts a bit like a debugger, so you can just pause your operating system and single step through all the instructions and modify bits in memory. It's really cool to fool around with these systems. So what kind of emulators can you actually use? I am focusing on Linux at the moment, under Linux and the BSDs. Basically, you only have SimH. SimH is from the Computer History Project. It's built by various engineers from Digital, Data General, Nova Eclipse, IBM, a bunch of old engineers, and they just preserve their heritage inside of this emulator. And it contains emulators for all the different PDP series. It contains emulators for a bunch of IBM card punching processing systems, the 1401, the 7509. It contains emulators for VUX, especially the VUX. Well, yeah, I like the VUX, and it's one of the more accessible emulated systems because of the software that runs on it. There are a bunch of others, however, they are really hard to get. For instance, getting an... if you're lucky, ask me. There are still alpha emulators available if you look around, however, and that allows you to run really current vintage operating systems. But most of the time, you're just stuck with SimH. So what can you actually run on these emulators then? Starting off in the 60s, you have most of the old DEC operating systems will run on these emulators. And I'm talking about things like RT11, process control. We have TSS8 running on the PyDP8. You can also just run that. RSX, TOPS 10, TOPS 20, most of the old DEC operating systems. OpenVMS is able to run on there. You're able to run almost every variant of Unix that has ever been created, except for the ones that have been programmed for the HP series of processor, because there is no emulator available for HP CPUs. You can run things like NextStep. Whoever wants to have their own NextStep system, well, you can run one in black and white. So, there is quite a lot of historic operating systems available. Most of these operating systems are kept online on the basis of Benware licenses or public granted licenses. I know, for instance, that Caldera has given a public domain license to most of the old Unix systems, which we'll be seeing later on. So you can actually get a lot of operating systems. Sometimes it's a bit more harder to get your hands on stuff. For instance, OpenVMS. If you want to run your own copy of OpenVMS, you will actually need to register with a digital user group. Yes, they still exist, because HP still the current owner of, the former owner of OpenVMS, but they still manage the license program. They require you to be part of one of those memberships, of user groups. And once you have your user group number, you can send an email to someone at HP, which will configure an account for you, and then you will get access to the full set of OpenVMS, the operating system, all the patches, all the software releases, and you will get yearly licenses, which you have to renew every year, but you're still able to run OpenVMS. There are ways around that if you ask around, though. But it's all not good and well, because there are quite some systems that you will not be able to emulate in any way. Most of the times this is because either the vendor disappeared, there is no documentation about the CPU, people need to sign heavy NDAs to get access to the CPU internals, and basically you're straight out of luck. For hobbyists, this means that all the SGI-based systems are for now off limits. There are people experimenting with extracting the ROMs from original SGI systems and using them together with QEMU and the MIPS emulator to run the systems, but this is nowhere near being able to boot their PROM-based software. So they're not even at the PROM stage. HP-based systems, HPPA, HPPA2, you're not able to emulate them. Again, HP doesn't release the documentation, and it's even hard to get Linux up and running on one of these systems. Let's see, what else do we have? Well, these are actually the biggest ones that I can think of. So, what do you do once you have these systems? I mean, it's fun. You start it up on your laptop, you fool around with it, and then what? There are a bunch of communities on the internet which actually are very active in vintage computing land. For instance, for silicon graphics based systems, you have the Neku-chan forum. And it's a very lively community which trades in SGI equipment, trades in software, and it's the place to be if you want to run a silicon graphics box. If you're into digital systems, there is a place called Hacknet, which is a worldwide layer 2 network based on top of tunnels, which runs a copy of the DECnet protocol suite. And The system has about, of that network has about 300 different systems attached. Two-thirds of them are emulated, but there are actually a bunch of real physical museum systems that are connected to this network. And if you get access to this network, you're just able to look into other people's museum systems, which can be really fun. Most of the other groups have died out. However, you can still find remnants of them. Another a really nice place to look around for OpenVMS help, for instance, is the VMS channel belonging to the Deathrow compute cluster. That's run by a bunch of VMS kernel engineers that used to run HackMe contests with OpenVMS boxes on hacker camps, among other things. All the hardware they ran their cluster on died out, so they didn't want to reboot it. But everybody is still online, and you can just ask these guys, and they've got VMS knowledge going back to Stone Age? I don't know. They just know everything. And since most of the original Usenet archives are preserved, you're able to use modern-day Usenet search engines to look up, well, basically everything that happened during the development of ARPANET and Internet and all the networks in between. And there is a wealth of information hidden in Usenet about the use of vintage computer systems. It's definitely, if you're going to spend time with these systems, you will spend a lot of time on Usenet. So, since this is all nice and well, I would love to actually show you a bunch of systems. And given the time, I can actually do a bunch of more demos than I expected. So, first off, you probably all recognize this famous picture. This is Ken Thompson and Dennis Ritchie sitting behind the teletype, behind the PDP-11, writing the very first version of Unix. We're actually going to run the operating system that they are running on this system. We're not going to do a full installation because the installation process is a bit borked on modern day operating systems, and I'm going to spare you the time for that. However, I've got a pre-installed disk image from this system, and we're going to run this, perform a tailor of the operating system, which is the after you've installed Unix to your disk, you need to tailor it for your own environment. And we're just going to run through the basic steps in doing this. So, let me get this out of the way. Oh boy, this is going to be fun. I hope you can... Oh, my terminal is not going to help with this. Oh boy. Let me do this differently. No, just give me a sec, because I really need to get this sorted properly. Yes. Can you all read this? Oh, yeah, the lights, that would be really handy. All right. So just to walk you through this, I've got a small file called demo.dsk, which is the pre-installed version of Unix. I've got a configuration file for the PDP-11 we will be using to run this system. And so what we will be configuring here is a PDP 11/45. I don't even know if I can measure the speed of the system in megahertz, but it's a small mid-sized PDP 11. We add CPU idle to this. Older operating systems use an idle loop to keep the CPU busy. However, this of course will result in 100% CPU usage if your system is idling on the host system. To prevent this from happening, we add set CPU idle, so the emulator will translate that to calls which will not load the host CPU, but still keep the timing accurate. Next up, we have a bunch of commands. We will just show some information. Next up, we will be configuring the RL disk controller, and we will have one disk attached to this. This is an RL02 disk, which is a 10 megabyte disk. Really big, of course, for the time. We will attach it to a file. Next up, we will configure the output TTI layer to be 7 bits because, yeah, Unix V7 uses 7 bits for console communications. Next up, we will be configuring a DZ interface, which is a 16-port serial port multiplexer, so we can emulate 16 terminals which are connected to the system, and you can use Telnet on your local system to connect to these. And I haven't tried this out to see if the drivers are available under Unix, but yeah, it's still in the config. And next up, we will just boot the CPU, and once that's done, we will exit the emulator. So, well, let's see how this goes then. So, hold on, let me just make the font size a little bit bigger. Yes, Arch Linux, I love this. Right, here we go. So to fire this up, I need to run in PDP 11 emulator. I've got one pre-installed here. And I just pass it the file name for the configuration. And boom, the emulator, ha, stupid me. Since I didn't rename the disk, it's trying to create a disk, and of course that's not how it's supposed to be. So we copy the demo disk to rl0open.dsk. Using making copies of these disk images is of course really nice. If you want to fool around and you're not quite knowing what you're doing, if you fuck something up, you just copy the image, boom, you've got everything back. So yeah, here we go. We've got the disk in place, so now we should be able to run the emulator. And here we go. Over here, you can see the add prompt. This is the bootloader for Unix. So what we're going to ask it to do is to boot. This will look up what the actual boot devices are. We only have configured the RL devices and the first disk attached to this with the first partition contains the kernel we want to load. So we type rld Unix. Please, did I type this correctly? Yes. Right, and as you can see, we're in the operating system now. However, since we need to tailor the operating system, there are a bunch of different things we need to do. This is basically single user mode. Yeah. So the first thing we need to do is create a TMP directory. Next up, the system has one user. Dennis and Richie, so, but he doesn't have a home directory, so we need to create that as well. And that's it. Now we can exit single user mode. And we've got our login prompt. As you can see, the system still thinks it's 9088, but then again, this system is not Y2K compliant, of course. So yeah, let's try it out. Let's see if we can actually log into the system. And boom, here we are. Okay, yeah. This is, and now we're logged in as, well, Dennis and Richie, of course. We can become root as well. And that's it. This is like, and now you're running an old school Unix. One of the things that's available on this specific variant of Unix is the PCC compiler. The PCC compiler is the precursor to the C compiler. It will allow you to compile C code, but it is not ANSI C compatible, so you will have to dig the old manuals to see which standards of C you can code in this. Yeah, this is a nice thing to, this is of course all nice and well. Given the time I have, I can also demo a different system for you. So let's just exit this system. Let me just do a quick check if my network is up and running. Okay. So what I've got here is a True64 Unix system. This is a variant of System 5 Unix that has been developed by Digital. It is weird in the sense that it is based on a monolithic kernel, but uses big parts of the MAH kernel to implement scheduling and threading. It is. It has preliminary clustering support, and well, this is a full installation of True64 that we're going to run. This is running on an alpha emulator, and I'm not supposed to have this alpha emulator, but I still got it. And for the demo effect, I would love to show it to you. The working is a bit differently than what we're used to. So instead of we first need to run, start the actual emulator. And this is basically the CPU console. Next up, we need to connect to its first serial port. And as you can see, we're connected to the EMU VM hardware emulator right now. And we've got the classical DEC chevron prompt. This basically means that we're in the bootloader. And that will allow us to, well, dig around. So let's see what kind of devices we have. And we've got, yeah, two disk devices, disk device, network device, and CD-ROM device. This is a full install, so let's boot it. This will take some time, of course. Just make this full screen because this is the most interesting thing, I guess. And well, this system is emulating, too bad, it's emulating a an ES40 alpha system, 833 megahertz CPU. Actually, pretty decent system for a vintage computer. Yes. There are license packs floating around for everything, basically, and they also get distributed among hobbyists. And they contain unlimited licenses for basically everything True64 ever had as a software release. One fun thing that you can see is back in the day when they were developing sockets, you basically had two different types of sockets. You have the BSD sockets, as you probably all know, and some of you might even program with, but AT&T also developed streams, which was an alternative to BSD sockets. And nowadays, almost nobody uses streams. Well, except for True64 and HP Unix. So, and since you're not able to run HP Unix on your own systems, this is your best bet to ever get a chance to play around with the streams socket layer, for instance. This is a full install. So yeah, it's starting up the world, basically. And it goes on and on and on and on. But I have prepared something nice on this box, so it's worth the wait, I guess. I did a bunch of True64 installs, and a full install, 2.5, 3 hours or something. But this also took really long. Because you're still emulating, all the hardware, and the emulator I'm using for this also comes in two variants, a JIT variant, which I'm not able to pay, and the guy also had a emulated variant, which was online until 2014, and I still use that because it's I just love the alpha, so. All right, let's get another terminal ready, because the system is equipped with X Windows, and it allows us to. Please let this work. Please let this work. Please let this work. Yes. Yes. And here we go. And here we have the common desktop environment, which was, well, basically in the time when X11 was still a thing, the common desktop environment was envisioned as a, well, the common graphical environment for Unix systems. Except that every vendor of Unix, of course, invented their own variant of CDE. And so, yeah, here you go. This is the graphical Unix environment that people have been working with in the 90s. And this is actually pretty fun because this also contains things like Netscape. And you can actually, I don't have NAT enabled on the system, and I don't have DNS setup, DNS forwarding enabled, so I can't demo the full system. But you can actually just, if it starts up, because it's slow like molasses, you can just run, well, 90s based stuff on your laptop. Given the time, I could also show you OpenVMS, but that's pretty boring compared to this. So I'm going to spare you with that. Oh yes, so, well, here we go. Long live Netscape, and let's just... Sorry? I think this is version... let's have a look. This is... 4.76. Yeah. There is actually, this is release 2650 of True64, which was released, if I'm not mistaken, in 2001 or 2002 or something. If you ask the correct HP person, really nice, you're able, there is a set of CD-ROMs available with version 31. Something which is patched up until 2017 and contains full security updates. But since HP is still making a lot of money of people that are still running True64, you need to know people or pay big bucks as a hobbyist, because you're not going to get access to it.
You should create a proxy that goes to the web archive and then shows the web as it was at that time.
It's actually one of my hobbyist plans, yes.
Okay.
At home, I'm in the process of building up a computer museum using vintage-only networking equipment with vintage-only operating systems, vintage-only programs, and the idea is a bit like, for instance, the HP Test Drive program. You sign up, you get allotted, say, a day of time on the network, and over the web or over a VPN tunnel, you access the system, full play around with it, and then log out, and you get to do whatever you want to do with them.
Well, I meant the proxy that when you open the URL in the browser, it will transparently proxy you to the web archive from...
Oh, like that. Oh, yeah, that could be. Oh, that actually could be fun. Yeah, I was actually thinking more about just digging archive.org, downloading websites, and just installing them on an old web server. And Yeah, that's actually, but yeah, then you don't get to play around with server technology from the 90s, of course. But everything is possible, and there are lots of different layers and different ways that you can play around with vintage computing. One thing I forgot to mention, one really important emulator, just because it's so bizarre, is the Hercules emulator. You probably all heard about the IBM Z-Series mainframe, huge ass system used in for financial systems, banking systems, insurance companies, huge ass, impossible to get as a hobbyist. However, the Hercules emulator implements a subset of the Z-Series mainframe, and there is a copy floating around of ZOS version 1.01, which allows you to run a full mainframe on your laptop. Not that you can do anything useful with it, but still, you know, it's... So yeah, are there any questions? Or not?
Not really a question, but more of a comment. Mm.
Oh, wow.
It's working like this.
Yes.
Yeah.
Which took me surprisingly long to find it.
No, hold on. Now, let me just get
the name of the shell, but it had a strange name.
And last up, just for the sake of it, I've been preparing all the images, all the demos you saw running on my laptop today, together with the OpenVMS demo. You can actually download them. I've added a bunch of scripts which allows you to get all the emulators, including the ones that you're not supposed to have. They will set you up with all the different configuration files, all the scripts you need to get this running on a Linux box. If you're on a non-Linux box, well, good luck. The scripts will contain all the information you need to get this up and running yourself. And well, thanks a lot for your time then.